All right, if you have your Bible with you, could you please turn to 2 Peter chapter 1, verse 12. 2 Peter chapter 1, verse 12. It is Mother's Day. One of the things that we do every year around here at Bentry on Mother's Day is we love to honor the moms. We love to celebrate moms, but we always worship Jesus. We don't worship moms. We don't worship dads on Father's Day. If there was a kids' day, we wouldn't worship kids on that day. We worship Jesus, and we focus on what he wants to teach us. And so, moms, we're thrilled you're here. We're glad that you're celebrating Mother's Day, and we're diving right back into our series, which is about how to read the Bible, because the Bible is a book that is not necessarily easy to grasp when you just jump right into it. But when you have a little groundwork, then you can mine the great truths that are found there. So we're spending 6 weeks to talk about how to read the Bible. We're looking at six specific words: spirit, story, simple, surrounding, study, and so what, which is two words, but that's okay. Last week, we talked about spirit. We talked about the fact that the Holy Spirit wrote the Bible, and the Holy Spirit explains the Bible to us. This week, we're going to talk about story. We're going to talk about the fact that the Bible is an amazing story straight from the heart of God. Once upon a time, well, actually, we can't start this story that way, can we? It probably should start this way. Once before once upon a time. It's the only story that starts before time. But that's not the only reason it's unique. Another reason it's unique is because this story is a composite of 66 different books. 66 books, one story. That's remarkable in and of itself. And this story was written by over 40 authors. 40 different people writing 66 different books, put it all together, one story. That's remarkable. It's even more remarkable when you realize that this story was written by 44 different authors, 66 different books, over somewhere between 1,400 and 1,700 years of time. That's crazy. Let me try to explain it this way. Imagine if we could get the writings of John Grisham, St. Francis of Assisi, who lived in the 1100s, Augustine of Hippo, who lived in 354, throw in Mark Twain, Leo Tolstoy, Robert Frost, Charles Dickens, and 33 other authors, take their writings, put them all together, and it comes out as one story. Can you even imagine what the chances are of something like that happening? Well, the chances are one in something. And here's the one. It's a supernatural thing that 66 books by 40 authors over 1,700 years tell one story. I asked you to turn to 2 Peter chapter 1, verse 12. In this text, Peter explains how this supernatural thing happens. He's talking about why he's writing scripture for us. So I will always remind you of these things, even though you know them and are firmly established in the truth that you now have. I think it's right to refresh your memory as long as I live in the tent of this body, because I know that I will soon put it aside, as our Lord Jesus Christ has made clear to me. So Peter knew he was about to die. And I will make every effort to see that after my departure, you will always be able to remember these things. So Peter wanted to make sure we knew the things that he was communicating. We did not follow cleverly invented stories when we told you about the power and coming of our Lord Jesus Christ, but we were eyewitnesses of his majesty. In other words, there were myths and stories out there, but we didn't grab onto the myths and stories. We actually were there and we saw the truth, and that's what we're communicating to you. Look in verse 19. And we have the word of the prophets made more certain, and you will do well to pay attention to it, as to a light shining in a dark place until the day dawns and the morning star rises in your hearts. Above all, you must understand that no prophecy of Scripture came about by the prophet's own interpretation. No Scripture came about because some person just sat down and wrote it. For prophecy never had its origin in the will of man, but men spoke from God as they were carried along by the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit had a story in his heart that he wanted to communicate to you and to me. And so over 1,700 years, through 44 different people and 66 different books, he put this story together, and that's what we hold in our hands. What I've learned over the years is that this story on God's work on our behalf is a lot easier to understand if you have a general outline of the story before you start. And so I'm going to take the next 30 minutes, and I'm going to outline generally in great detail. Sounds like an oxymoron, but it's what I'm going to try and do. Generally, in great detail, the story of the Bible. I need you to write this down. So take out some paper, take out a pen, take notes. Okay, you're going to be writing. I'm going to be writing. I'm going to be drawing on my white, trusty whiteboard here. But if you take this down and you listen and you engage in this conversation, at the end of this service, you will have a feel for the entire story of Scripture and where the books of the Bible fit into that story. I think it'll be really helpful for you. I trust that it will, okay? So the first thing I'm going to do is I'm going to show you an overview of the story, and then we'll break it into three parts. Please excuse me for turning my back on you here, but in order to draw, I have to be able to do that. All right, so here's an overview of the whole story. Got it? Okay, draw that on a piece of paper. And I'm going to give you the six acts. I can't get the cap off my pen. Never mind. I use this pen. The six acts of Scripture, all right? Act number one. Intent. That is a bad pen. I apologize. Intent. What did God intend when he made creation? And we're going to write one word here. Life. He intended life. We'll describe that in more detail in just a second. Act two. There we go. Fall. Fall. I'm going to call this loss of life. You're about to see the key word in the story as we go through this. All right? Act three, plan. This is God's incredible plan to restore what? Life. To restore life, okay? Act four is way over here. Act four is victory. Victory is life provided. Life is provided. Act five, I'm going to call it new life. This is life shared or life spread. Act six, I'm going to call it everlasting. Are you running out of room? They were rebelling first hour when I got to this point. Life enjoyed. Okay, so here is the simple story of Scripture. God intended to bring life. We messed it up and we lost life. He came up with a plan to restore life. This plan included this victory of this person, Christ, who provided life, bringing a group of people who shared in that life and then spread that life around the world, taking us to a place where everlasting life is enjoyed forever, which if you want, you could say at this point, the original intent is restored, and that is the heartbeat of the story. That is the heartbeat of the story. Okay, so here's what I'm going to do now. I'm going to tell you three parts of the story. One, two, three. Okay, this right here, write 400 in here. This is 400 years of silence, okay? Everything to the left of that line is the Old Testament. Everything to the right of this line is the New Testament. This period here is called the intertestamental period. in between the two testaments. And there are 400 years where God doesn't say anything. It's just silent. And then the New Testament starts. And I'm going to walk you through this part, and this part. Okay? You ready? Yes. All right, I'm about to erase this. Ah! Okay, so first hour I said, I'm about to erase this. And everyone's like, no, wait. And so I waited for a second. And then I'm like, okay, you guys done yet? And I looked over here and there's a guy over there going, come on, get this thing moving. So I know some of you aren't quite ready yet. Some of you, okay, we're going to try and produce this for you. We'll put it on our webpage. So if you're frantically taking notes, please keep taking notes. But if you don't get it all, we'll try and help you with that, all right? So here it goes. Okay, so that's the overview. That's the overview. Now take out a new piece of paper because we're going to look at that first section of the story now. Okay. All right. First section of the story. About a third of the way down your paper, turn sideways. Just draw a nice line straight across. Okay? I'm going to walk you through the history and show you where the books of the Bible fit into that history and show you the main characters at each part, okay? Because that's how you'll figure out the story. So going back to our summary, here's Act 1, intent. And our key characters here, of course, are Adam and Eve. And God put them in the garden, so you can draw a little tree if you want. There's a piece of fruit. A lot of you think it was an apple. It doesn't actually say that it was an apple. It's just fruit of some kind. Okay, and so the intent was life. God gave life to people, right? And then he said, now part of life is sharing life with me. And so he wanted to enjoy intimacy with them. And so they lived together, God and Adam and Eve, and they had absolute freedom and intimacy with him. It was what God intended. Unfortunately, it did not last long. We get to Act 2 very quickly in Scripture, okay? And we call this the fall. This is the part where we lose life. Adam and Eve got rebellious, and they ate the one piece of fruit that God told them not to. They wanted to be like God. This is the sin that most people still struggle with. We want to be God in our life, right? Adam and Eve wanted to be God in their own life and not God, have God as God in their life. And so this brought about the fall. And with the fall came sin and pain and illness and injury, ultimately death, which is the loss of life. And obviously, this is a major problem. Because the fall came into the world, people were desperate. God threw Adam and Eve out of the garden. He put a big sign in the form of an angel that said, keep out. They weren't allowed in the garden anymore. And people just went into the tank. I mean, all of society, everyone just walked away from God. And if you want to draw a little boat here, you can. Because this is Noah. And God brought the flood, and in the flood, he brought judgment on the evil of mankind. He rescued one family, and he started over. And that brings us to Act 3. Act 3, which is the plan. God says, we've got a problem. My intention was life, and to share life with the people that I love. But because sin has separated me from them, they are experiencing death, the loss of life. So I have a plan to restore life to those who have lost it. And this plan centered around a man named Abraham. God said, I'm going to choose this one guy, and I'm going to give him a family, and I'm going to make that family a nation. I'm going to bless that nation. And then through that nation, they will be a blessing to all of mankind, because through that nation, I will bring a special person. And that special person will deal with the problem of sin, pain, and death, find victory over sin, pain, and death, and make life available again. And so God gave Abram 12 sons. 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12. And those 12 sons became 12 tribes, and they became a great nation. Hundreds of years later, they were struggling to find food, and so they went down to Egypt to find food. It's a great story at the end of Genesis. And they found themselves all of a sudden in bondage in Egypt. So you can draw the pyramids here if you want. They found themselves in bondage for Egypt For about 430 years, they were slaves there. And they were in deep, deep trouble. This is what I want to do. I want to show you where the books of the Bible fit. So right here, everything I just told you about, right down here, the book of Genesis. I know what some of you are thinking. Seriously? We're only through Genesis? How long has he been talking? You realize how important Genesis is, don't you? When you see that Act 1, Act 2, and the beginning of Act 3 all happens in Genesis. It's an incredibly important book. There's another book of the Bible that comes from this time frame. I don't know if you know this or not, but write it down here too. It's the book of Job. The book of Job. Most scholars believe that Job was the first Bible book written, even before Genesis. And that Job was probably a contemporary of Abraham. He probably lived during the time of Abraham, and he was obviously someone who had a relationship with God, and there's an incredible story in Job that if you've read the book, you're aware of. If not, I encourage you to read that. And so all of a sudden, our people of Israel are in bondage in Egypt for 430 years. God wanted to get them out of bondage and get them into the promised land that he had prepared for them. And so he raises up the next character, and his name is Moses. Moses. Moses was a farmer. And his weapon was a staff. And God tapped him on the shoulder and said, I want you to get my people out of there. And you remember the story, many of you, he went into Egypt and through the Red Sea and took the people out into the wilderness and started taking them towards the promised land. And while they were on their way towards the promised land, God took him up onto the mountain and gave him what's called the law, which was how God wanted the people of Israel to live in the midst of all the wretched peoples around them. And then God did something else that was fascinating during this time. He came to dwell among his people in a tent. And that tent was called the tabernacle, because God wanted to be with his people. Remember, his original intent was, I want to be with you. And he wanted to be with them, although he couldn't be intimate with them. And so there was this elaborate system of certain curtains that were keeping people out. And there was the Holy of Holies where God dwelled. And only once a year was one person allowed to go in there. And that's all in the tabernacle here, okay? And so here are the books of the Bible where this is all described. Genesis, Exodus, Leviticus. That's where it talks about the law, right? Numbers. And Deuteronomy. Moses wrote all five of these books, Genesis, Exodus, Leviticus, Numbers, Deuteronomy. It's called the Pentateuch, Penta, five, Tuch, book, five books. It's the first five books of the Bible. Moses wrote them, and they describe this whole section of history. Moses, for a number of reasons, was not allowed to take the people of Israel into the promised land. And his successor, a guy named Joshua, was. Joshua was not a farmer. God made him a warrior. And that was a good thing, because there was a lot of people living in the promised land, and Joshua had to lead the people of Israel in and go to war against those people to give the people the land that God had promised them. I've got colors, you don't, but I'm going to do this anyway. These are grapes, big, juicy grapes. And the promised land was an amazing land. It says it was flowing with milk and honey. And the people of Israel came to dwell in the land as Joshua led them. Now, this story takes place in Joshua, Judges, and Ruth. Is during this time frame as well. Joshua talks about coming in and taking the land. Judges talks about the people after the land had been divided amongst them all. The judges were the rulers. They're the ones that led the people. They were a mess. Just one mess after another, after another, after another. So eventually, the people of Israel started crying out to God with a simple refrain. We want a king. All the other nations have a king. We want a king to lead us, right? And so God eventually relented and said, okay, you can have a king. So let's draw a king here. Yeah, that's a great king right there. Okay, the first king, his name was Saul. Saul didn't work out. The next king, his name was David. David was a man after God's own heart, and God promised David, this man that I promised way back here, he's going to come through your line. He's going to be a king of David. So David was the line through which he would come. And David had a son called Solomon, who is quite famous as well. If you want to read about David, you can read about him in 1 and 2 Samuel and the book of Psalms. Many of the Psalms are songs that were written by David, and so you get a feel for the historical context of the Psalms when you see the timeline like this. If you want to learn about Solomon, read 1 Kings 1 through 11, and then Solomon wrote quite a bit of scripture too, right? He wrote the Song of Solomon. He wrote Ecclesiastes, ECC, period. And he wrote a lot of Proverbs as well. And so these are obviously very important characters in Old Testament history, all right? So we want a king. He gave him a king. This is what was called the United Kingdom, the original United Kingdom. The people of Israel were united under Saul first, then David, then Solomon. And this is the first epic of our timeline of biblical history. After Solomon, everything fell apart in a big way. And I'm going to show you what that looks like now. So here we go. Okay, so take out another piece of paper. This is your second sheet. This is the second part of that timeline. Are you following me? Yes? All right. All right, sheet number two. Now, this, pay attention on this because this is the part that when you're reading through the Bible, this is where you get all messed up. You get all confused and all lost, and it's really confusing. I'm going to explain it to you, and it won't confuse you anymore, all right? So this time, we're going to draw it like this. Oh, this pen. All right, there's the 400 years, okay? Okay, so after Solomon, there was a civil war. I don't know if you knew this or not, but that was the United Kingdom. We're now going to look at what's called the Divided Kingdom because there was a civil war. And the nation of Israel was split into two different nations, okay? One, the Northern Kingdom, was called Israel. This is why it gets a little confusing, otherwise known as the Northern Kingdom. And the other nation was called Judah, or the Southern Kingdom. And because Jerusalem was found in Judah, many times it's just called Jerusalem, okay? And so from this point on in history, God is dealing with Israel, the Northern Kingdom, and Judah. And if you don't know that this took place, then when he's talking about Israel, you're thinking it's the whole Israel, and it can be quite confusing, right? Now I want you to put some exclamation points on here. I want you to put an exclamation point right here. And we're going to put the date too, 721. Then we're going to put an exclamation point right here. This is B.C. 586 B.C. And these exclamation points show us where the people were taken into exile. You see, all through this time, God's hope for Israel that they would be a holy people, they'd walk with him in holiness and intimacy, and then as they did, he would raise up this Messiah out of them. The problem is the people kept failing miserably, time after time after time. Eventually, God said, okay, you continue to fail. I'm going to allow you to be conquered and taken away. Maybe that will get your attention, but don't worry, I'm going to bring you back one day, which is exactly what he did near the end of the Old Testament, and we'll write restoration here. Restoration. He restores the people of Israel back to the land. Okay, now there were a couple important things that took place. Solomon built the temple, right? But here in 586, When the Babylonians came down and took the people of Judah captive, they destroyed the temple and they destroyed the wall that surrounded Jerusalem. And this was a very, very dark season. But during the restoration, the temple was rebuilt, albeit on a much smaller scale, and the wall was rebuilt as well. And after this time of great restoration and celebration and rebuilding, there was a tremendous moral decline among the people of Israel. During this season, there were some men, okay? So we'll draw them like this. These guys are called prophets. In a number of different ways, they came out and they said, hey, God is speaking to you. Thus saith the Lord, God says, and they were the mouthpieces of God to these people during these years. And what's really helpful, I think, is to know which prophet was speaking to which group at which time, because there's so many different seasons in the life of Israel during this time. So let me just plot them on here, write them on there, and then we'll talk about why this is important, okay? So Amos spoke to Israel during a time of great prosperity, but also a time of great evil. Jonah did too, although he was directing his diatribe towards Nineveh. Hosea prophesied to Israel right at the very time when they were under siege and when they were taken into exile. So it's important to know the historical context behind Hosea. Nahum, spoke to Israel shortly before they were brought back from exile and restored back into the land. Most of the prophets spoke to the nation of Judah. And let me just show you where they find themselves. Micah was the earliest. Isaiah was back here too, both before the destruction of Jerusalem. Zephaniah actually spoke a little bit towards Israel as well, so I'll put him a little farther north. These prophets spoke exactly during the time of the conquest and the time of exile. Joel, Ezekiel, Jeremiah, and the book of Lamentations was written by Jeremiah at a time of great grief as he watched the temple and the wall destroyed and Jerusalem laid bare and the people taken off into bondage. That's why Lamentations is such a sad book. Daniel was written right around here, near the end of the exile period. Esther goes right here. Esther goes right there as the people of Israel are starting to return. Obadiah was left behind. He wasn't taken into bondage with the rest of those from Judea. Haggai spoke right here. Haggai was speaking to the people of Israel and Judah as they came back into the land during the time of the rebuilding of the temple and the rebuilding of the wall, as did Zechariah. Malachi, the last prophet, otherwise known as the Italian prophet, Malachi wrote to Israel as they fell into moral decline after the rebuilding of the temple and the rebuilding of the wall. If you want to look at the history of this, you can read about all these kings in 1 and 2 Kings. If you read about this whole history, including the restoration, you can go to 1 and 2 Chronicles. You can also read about the rebuilding of the wall and the temple in Ezra and Nehemiah. Nehemiah is the shortest biblical writer. Nehi, have you ever heard that joke? No. Okay, so this is helpful because you can see that Amos was speaking to a very different situation than Malachi was, right? So his content's gonna be very different. Jeremiah, you can understand why he's known as the weeping prophet. Because look what was going on when he was preaching, when he was saying, hey, this is what God's up to, right? Lamentations, oh, I see why he was so bummed out, because everything's been laid waste. Once you get the historical context, it makes it easier to understand what those prophets are doing. Now, here's what the prophets did. put a dot there and then an arrow going forward. The prophets spoke to a specific season, a specific moment in time, and I've just told you what those are, but they also were predicting about things in the future. They were doing both of those at the same time. That's why these books are so rich, and that's why they're kind of hard to understand sometimes. These are a bit of a challenge, okay? So this is all still part of the plan. The problem is the people of Israel didn't cooperate with the plan. And so we get to the end of the Old Testament, at the end of Malachi, and all of a sudden God stops talking. 400 years of nothing. And that's the end of Act 3. Oh, see. One more sheet of paper. I'm going to show you the third part right now. You hanging there with me? Hang in there. This is good to know. All right. On this one, we're going to draw another line just straight across, about a third of the way down our page. And we're going to look at the New Testament real briefly here. Act 4. Victory. Life is provided. And this, okay, so this is a manger. A little baby in it. Okay? This is when Jesus comes on the scene. The incarnation, the Son of God, the one who's been promised all the way through the plan, finally arrives at just the right time. He lives a perfect life. He goes to the cross, sacrificially makes himself available to the Father. And his death makes atonement, reconciliation, justification, regeneration, all those things possible. He's buried. 3 days later, he raises again from the dead. He then ascends to heaven. And this is Act 4. There are four books in the Bible that tell this story. Matthew, Mark, Luke, John. And here's what these guys are doing. They're all looking at this person, Jesus. And they're telling the same story, but Matthew's looking at it from this angle, Mark is looking at it from this angle, Luke from this angle, John from this angle. So when you read all four of these stories, you get a really well-rounded picture of who this Christ is and the fact that he made it possible for us to live because of his work on the cross and the fact that he came back to life. Act 5. Jesus returns in the form of the Spirit. And these are tongues of fire that you can read about in Acts chapter 2. And the way that Jesus promised, he said, I'll send my Spirit and he'll come and indwell you. And so he provided life. Act 5 is all about the people who received life. He put them together in little groups called the church. And then their job was to spread life to the rest of the world. There were two key characters in this time, Paul and Peter. And this is really important if you don't know this. The book of Acts, right? Acts down here. The book of Acts tells the history of the rest of the New Testament, all the way to the end. And so if you read the book of Acts through and through, you'll get the story of the early church, and everything else in the New Testament fits into the book of Acts in some way, shape, or form. Acts chapter 12 is kind of a turning point. Up until Acts chapter 12, Peter is kind of the key player because he is taking the gospel to the Jews. After chapter 12, Paul is the key player, and he is taking the gospel to the rest of the world, or to the Gentiles. Paul does this through missionary journeys. One missionary journey, second missionary journey, third missionary journey, then a fourth journey, which wasn't a missionary journey. He got arrested and then he got taken to Rome under arrest. And that's basically the story of the book of Acts. That's the rest of the story as far as the New Testament church is concerned in Scripture. And what's interesting to know is that this is when Paul did most of his writing. And I'll just tell you when he did which writing. During his second missionary journey, he wrote 1 and 2 Thessalonians. During his third missionary journey, he wrote 1 Corinthians, 2 Corinthians. He wrote Galatians and Romans while he was on the road. And then while he was in prison, he really got writing. He had a lot of time on his hands, right? So he wrote Philemon. He wrote Colossians, Ephesians, Philippians, 1
So 2 Timothy was the last letter that Paul wrote, and that's important to know as you're working through the New Testament. There's other letters that were written at this point too. 1 and 2 Peter was written about now. Hebrews, we don't know the author of Hebrews. Could have been a number of different people. Jude was written now as well. Right here, draw a gravestone. It says, rest in peace. It's about 65. Right around 65, both Peter and Paul died. And someone else emerged as kind of the vocal leader of the church, and his name was John. He was always a leader. He was one of the inner circle with Christ. And John, he didn't die until about 96. He was the last one. He was sent to a place called Patmos, which is a Greek island, and he was exiled there. And it's from Patmos that he wrote the Gospel of John. He wrote 1st, 2nd, and 3rd John, really creatively named. And then Revelation. And Revelation was his vision of Acts 6, which is everlasting life. And this includes the return of Christ. It includes the establishment of the New Jerusalem, the new heavens, the new earths, and everything that's going to happen from this point forward. And the fact that because of Christ and what he did, life is possible again. This is a brief, detailed, general summary of the entire Bible. Oh, stop. Here's what I want you to do with this, all right? A couple of things I want you to do. I want you to know why it's important that we know this. It's really important that we know this. A couple of reasons why. Number one, because knowing the whole story eliminates confusion. So when you're reading during the Civil War time, you get what's going on. When you're reading a certain prophet, you understand why he's saying the things he's saying. It gives you a breadth of knowledge that eliminates confusion. It also provides a historical context. The fact that Amos is speaking to a prosperous nation that's full of evil should make us go, that sounds familiar. Maybe Amos's message is really appropriate for us today because we live in a prosperous nation that's full of evil as well. It aids in application. It helps us applying scripture. And we're going to have a whole sermon on applying scripture. But knowing the whole sequence helps us realize that we're going to apply Leviticus differently than we apply Ephesians because they're written to different people at different times for different purposes. So it helps us in our application. It keeps the main thing the main thing. The main thing of the story is life. God intended us to enjoy life with him. We blew it, and we lost life. He came up with a plan to restore life. Jesus was victorious in proclaiming and providing life. Anyone who says yes to Jesus receives life, and one day we'll get to experience everlasting life the way it was intended originally. It keeps the main thing the main thing. And I think it just adds to the awe of Scripture, too. The fact that Job was one of the most ancient people in Scripture is important to know. It's helpful to know. So when we're reading like Job 38 this week, did you notice that part when he was starting to name the constellations? And I said to Libby, I said, look at this. He knew what Orion was. Don't you tend to think of people way in the ancient world kind of more like cavemen? You know, kind of like fire, fire, meat, meat, my meat, fire, fire, meat. Job wasn't one of those guys at all. This guy understood the constellations. He studied the skies. He knew what they were called. He was an educated guy. And knowing that and knowing how old he was brings a depth to the book of Job that you didn't have before. So knowing this, I think, adds to the awe. Here's what I'd like you to do this week. A couple things. Number one, go home and redraw that thing. Because I know it's a mess, right? And we did it really fast, so redraw it. Number two, teach it to your children. Sit down and say, hey, I want to tell you the story of the Bible, and just draw it out for them. Two reasons you want to do that. One, because your kids need to know this. And two, because you will learn it if you teach it. Okay? So draw it out, teach it to your children. And then here's a third thing I'd like you to do. This week, we're going to be reading seven more chapters together. They're chapters from Psalms and Proverbs, Isaiah, Daniel, John. What I want you to do before you read the chapter, I want you to do a little research into the historical context. Look at your sheet, figure out what's going on. Maybe Google and just ask the question, what's the historical context of Daniel chapter 7? Just Google that. You'd be stunned at what you can find. Just do a little reading and a little learning before you read the chapter so that you can get a feel for how that can make such a difference as we read and study the Bible together. All right, stand with me. I want to pray for you. Please. That sounded really bossy. I didn't mean that. As bossy as it sounded. Lord, I've just fire hosed my people with this incredible story written by more than 40 people over 1,700 years. What a beautiful message that you want us to experience the life that you intended all along, and that through the person of Jesus, that's possible for us. Thank you for that truth. Thank you for the gospel. Thank you for communicating it to us. Lord, as we spend time in your word this week, bring it to life. Breathe life into it for us. Let us see your truth. Reveal yourself to us. Reveal your son to us. Strangely warm our hearts as we read, I pray. And then let's get into some great conversations about what we're learning. Grow us as a body, I pray, and I pray it in Jesus' precious name. Amen.